Good evening. I call to order the regular meeting of the Perry Municipal Authority. It is September 19, 2016. Roll call, please.
Strowler.
Here.
Horrell.
Here.
Platt. Eversole.
Here.
Marshall.
Here.
Franklin.
Here.
Gilbert.
Here.
Calder.
Here.
Johnson.
Here. Thank you. I do declare a quorum. This evening, our invocation is going to be done by Gloria Brown. Ms. Brown.
Father, you're such a good, good God. We just thank you as we celebrate our heritage this past weekend, that we also reflect upon the many blessings that you've poured out upon our community. But Father, looking forward, we know that you want to continue to bless us, so we just ask tonight that you empower these leaders that so graciously give of their time to lead the city. Give them wisdom and help them to make decisions that would help us to grow. Help us to be like a city set on a hill that others will look at and we can be an example for. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Gloria. Item one, the consent agenda. Receive and approve the minutes of the regular PMA meeting of September 6, 2016. Do I have a motion?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Strowler.
Yes.
Horrell.
Yes.
Eversole.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Calder.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes. Comments from those assembled, item four, concerning the PMA. Is there any comments this evening?
You can skip over that.
I think we skip over that. Item five, proclamation, commendation, reports, and inquiries by the governing body. I do like to just shout out to the chamber and all the other organizations that got involved in the celebration. It took an effort from a lot of different organizations around. We had over 100 entries and it went well. We want to thank our marshals for doing that and taking care of the people, lining up the bands and floats and all that. Shout out to all that did anything for that at all. All I had to do was ride on one float and go watch the rest. It went smooth. It was a lot of fun for everybody. So thanks to everybody. Anyone else? Item six, OMPA update. Jennifer Rogers. Ms. Rogers.
Hello. How are we doing?
Good.
Good. Okay, so I just got a brief update. Nothing too major going on right now, but good news is OMPA is growing. Cordell became our 42nd member city, so there's not much more cities we can keep picking up, but we keep picking up the ones that we can. I want to give the citizens of Perry and also yourselves a heads up. OMPA is going to be conducting our biannual customer satisfaction survey, so which means that a survey company will be calling the customers' homes, asking them to take a short survey to see how the city is doing on their electric service, what kind of programs and services they would like to see in the future. This survey is what we use to give the city to show their measurements, and we break Perry up because they are one of our larger ones, to see how they're doing on customer service, but also to see what kind of programs and services that the customers might like to see that OMPA could provide maybe in the future. So that's going to be starting here within like a week or two. So those customer surveys will be starting, I'm pretty sure that Drake told me next week, but we'll see. So.
Will they be able to give other input as well, Jennifer?
Yes, there's an open comment section at the end. The survey takes about 5 minutes, so it's pretty detailed on reliability, programs and services, customer service at the city hall, what other things, your rates and whatnot. So there will
That's
be.
That's where I was going with that. Mm-hmm. We're hearing an awful lot on rates and yes.
You are not the only one, which you'd be surprised.
Because oh,
every city is like that. And right now, keep in mind on that survey, like that's how we came up with our energy audit program and even our ceiling insulation program, is because of high bill complaints. We thought, what else can we do to kind of offset this? And so that kind of ties into some of the programs that we still offer. So yes, there is an open comment section, and I don't know how many they're going to poll for. I think they poll around 150 to 200 in Perry. So I mean, it's going to be kind of pick and choose, and whoever decides, and a lot of people end up hanging up, so, and whoever we can get to actually take the survey. So, yes, feel free to.
And you need a certain number of responses for it to be a valid survey.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we really want to encourage.
Encourage participation, so.
Pro or con, we gotta have it.
Yeah.
Is this only gonna be phone, there's not like a website link?
No, we're just doing phone because, I mean, we had talked about possibly doing a web survey, but given we have 42 cities, not everybody keeps email addresses of their customers on file, so really phone is the only preferred method, and mail is just way too expensive. So that's why we do the phone survey. Okay, Public Power Week is the week of October 2nd through the 8th. Perry's gonna hold their celebration on October 5th. I think it's mid-morning, right? Is that mid-morning?
It's all morning.
Okay, OMPA, well, actually myself, I'll be the one in attendance for OMPA, so we'll have some giveaways too. So be sure if you're downtown, stop by Perry City Hall and get you some free giveaways, because you guys are a public power community, and this is our way of showing the citizens of what it means to own your own electric utility and give back to the city. So there's a lot of educational handouts we'll have. So we will have all employee training, which will be for the City of Perry employees on September 29th at the Exchange Bank, and that'll be in the afternoon. So that's open to all the employees for the City of Perry. It's our continued training, and since you guys are involved in CUP, which is the Competitive Utility Program, training is a huge part of CUP program, so it helps you get that $20,000 check that we give you each year. So we highly encourage, if any employees, yeah, make sure you attend. OMPA, our newest program, which came out of the survey we did 2 years ago, is the Residential Ceiling Insulation Program. And the City of Perry does participate now. What the Ceiling Insulation Rebate Program is it ties hand in hand with our Residential Energy Audit Program. The customer has to have a residential energy audit done first, which is absolutely free. And then if they take the auditor's recommendation and add ceiling insulation, you can either do it yourself or you can hire a contractor to do it. But the city and OMPA will give you a rebate if you add ceiling insulation. It has to be up to a certain R value, and I think the auditor will recommend what R value you need on your ceiling insulation once he does your audit. But it's a 50-50 match program, like the heat pump rebate program is, but there is a cap. The cap is $500. So if you start adding insulation and you spend a little bit more than $500, the maximum rebate you're going to get from the city and OMPA is going to be $500. So it's $250 from OMPA and $250 from the city. So I know that a lot of people are going to be complaining about high bills right now, and we're hearing it from all over the state. So we like to remind them that we have that residential energy auditor, and it's completely free to any of the City of Perry's electric customers. So if you feel like something's going on at your home and your bills are way too high than what they normally should be, would recommend you have an energy audit.
Mary, have we had very many take advantage of that?
We have quite a few. Of the energy audit or the ceiling insulation?
Both.
Both. We've had quite a few of the energy audit.
And the ceiling insulation just started, so it's very new, so we haven't even had. At OMPA, out of our 42 cities, we've only processed like 16 rebates so far because it's brand new.
Okay.
It's a brand new program. And I am getting Autumn some brochures to go out on the ceiling insulation and bill stuffers for you guys.
We did.
You did? Okay, good. Okay, good deal. Power supply, OMPA, we are going to be purchasing an additional 41.4 megawatts of wind. And that will not come online until 2020, and that's up in the Grand Plains Wind Farm, which is just west of Ponca City. So it was just, wind is really cheap right now, and it's just why we bought into it. And a lot of people ask me when I go and do city council updates with the state of Oklahoma and the deficit due, and you guys having wind farms, are you guys going to be under attack? And the answer is no. If they do away with the wind subsidiaries, the way our contracts are written, we won't be out any money because we pay the same amount no matter what underneath that contract. So it would be that out-of-state company that actually built the wind farm and we just purchased the power from. So I do get that question. Our demand and energy efficiency program has been widely popular in Perry. You guys are one of our cities that take the most advantage of the DEEP program, which is rebates for commercial and industrial customers, and we actually just gave Ditch Witch, I think it was like $12,000 for a lighting upgrade. So We like to keep it, we like to inform customers, especially your commercial, industrial, and that is completely OMPA's money. None of it comes from the city of Perry. It's strictly out of OMPA's pocket. So if you upgrade any motors, air conditioners, heat pumps, lighting, chillers, boilers, food service equipment, just give us, give the city a call and we'll have our commercial energy engineer come out and take a look at the facility and see if it qualifies. So with that, that is my big update. So do we have any questions? No?
One of the things last week, Alex Dobson and mm-hmm. the contractor, they were working at the substation this last week, adding the new switcher.
Okay.
I believe it is. So
good deal.
That will improve reliability.
Nice.
Out at our substation. So.
Good. They don't tell me over an engineer what they do.
Actually, I think Alex took quite a few photos throughout the week.
Okay, good.
And so hopefully we'll all have access to those and get those posted on our web pages.
Yeah, I'll let him know.
Okay.
I'll yell at him tomorrow.
Yeah.
Say hey.
The survey, when will that information be available?
They are supposed to have it. Well, the calls will take place within the next 2 weeks, but it takes them a while to develop the whole entire consensus of the responses. But it'll be presented, I think, at our November board meeting, I want to say, possibly, or December. So you guys should have a copy of your survey by the end of the year to know what your customers said.
The program for the commercial, I was asked about this by a guy last week, and I told him that just come to City Hall and we can help them out, find out the program and mm-hmm. the contact on that. So
yeah.
There are some interests around town peaking.
Good.
The commercial
Great.
Users. They need to do it too.
Yeah. Might as well. It's free money from OMPA.
There you go.
We take advantage of it. Okay.
Well, thank you, Jennifer.
Well, thank you guys. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Have a safe trip back home.
Thanks.
All right, item 7, new business. Any new business be brought before the council this evening? Seeing none, item 8.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Motion and second to adjourn. Roll call, please.
Ms. Trawler.
Yes.
Morrill.
Yes.
Eversole.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Caldern.
Yes.
Yes.
Consider being here.
All right, now. Consent agenda. Items A through H and H, pardon me? Oh, you got to call Rowan. Call Rowan.
Stroller.
Here.
Oh, wait.
I thought we just called Rowan. That's the end of the other one.
That's the other one.
I called to order the council meeting of the city of Perry, Oklahoma. It's September 19th, 2016. Roll call, please.
Stroller.
Here.
Morrill.
Here.
Platt. Eversole.
Here.
Marshall.
Here.
Franklin.
Here.
Gilbert.
Here.
Caldern.
Here.
Johnson.
Here. Mentally, finally.
Get
I do declare a quorum. Consent agenda, item A through H. H has six parts, and any of those items in that consent agenda you wish to remove and discuss further, please make the motion that way. If not,
motion approved.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Stroller.
Yes.
Morrill.
Yes.
Eversole.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Caldern.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes. Comments from those assembled? Anyone with comments concerning the council meeting this evening? Seeing none, item 6.5, proclamation, commendation, reports, and inquiries by the governing body. Council, staff, anyone need to make a report or inquiry of the council? Seeing none, city manager's report update.
Okay. Well, we'll start off with number one. Under the Federal Safe Drinking Water Act, water systems like Perry, public water supply systems, are required to test for contaminants, and that includes lead. The federal lead and copper rule requires us to monitor tap water from inside homes that are, these are homes that are built before 1986 that are more likely to have lead internal plumbing. And so we only do this, I think, every 3 years, and this is our year to do that. So city employees have already delivered the sample kits to the approved list of DEQ locations. And I think it was in the neighborhood of about 30 locations, and we've already collected those samples and sent them to the lab for testing. So it's a program that's required by DEQ under the EPA, Federal Clean Safe Drinking Water Act. And once we get the results of those samples, then we will go back and notify the people that we sampled their water and notify them of the results, so that they'll know. Now, there are some that are outside the parameters. We may have to take some additional steps, but we'll cross that bridge when we get there. But, you know, it's just one of those that, you know, some of the people have been on that list before, so they knew exactly what Melissa was knocking on the door for, and they knew the drill. They went and drew the water from the tap. It has to be the kitchen or the bathroom. And others who were new on the list, you know, she explained to them, and everything went fine. So she was real pleased that she was able to get that all done last Friday and sent off to the lab.
The results of that, will it be a public record and sent out to
we're only required to notify those that that were sampled. You know, that's the requirement. It's part of our annual consumer confidence report that we publish once a year. So that those results will be part of that when we do the 2016
report. I just thought what they're doing, approximately 30 sites, if they did find a problem and they'd want to sample more, site again or those sites again and then the others.
Right. Well, it has to do with the internal plumbing. Mm-hmm.
Within the home
itself. Within the home itself, yeah. Okay. and not city system.
Okay, gotcha.
So let the residents know they have to let problem
right.
More than it is.
Right.
Delivery system.
And there are certain mitigation things that they can do to mitigate the issues, like let your water run a little bit longer before you actually, fill up your glass or whatever the case may be. So, but you know, like I said, if it comes to that, we'll work with the homeowners or the residents and let them know what the issues are and how we can help them.
Thank you.
And I do want to say that this doesn't have anything to do with the taste and smell issues that we've been having. We have noticed, or continuing to notice, apparently some folks have some issues with the taste and the smell, and so we just encourage people to call into the water plant or City Hall. Just posting on Facebook, we don't see those posts, or may not see them for a couple of days, and just a name doesn't really tell us anything. If they'll just call City Hall, 4241, or the water plant, 4100, report their location, and it may be as simple as going out and flushing a line that's in that area, and we can isolate the problems. But there's a lot of reasons why there might be taste and smell problems. It could be, lake turnover, it could be runoff, and it could be algae bloom, whatever the case may be. And so we've been trying to address those issues, as best we can with the, given the requirements that we're under. The main thing is that our water is safe to drink, and received a copy of a letter, if I can read this. This is from DEQ. It was in response to a citizen concern in Perry, and it was determined by DEQ that the public water department is providing water that meets or exceeds primary drinking water standards. The issue of taste and odor reported in the water is considered a secondary standard and is not regulated. So that's kind of had been working with DEQ, and that's what they advised us. And so now that's, in response to a letter of concern, DEQ responded to the local citizen with that response. So. And, we're not the only community that's having this. So, you're hearing about in other communities too. It has to do, you know, if you have lake water, surface water, you're good, that's, you know, it's going to be an issue.
Yearly.
Yes, could be yearly. If you have well water, it's, you know, not particularly an issue. Code enforcement asked me to announce tonight that over the next couple of weeks, they're going to be focusing on a couple of areas, and they just wanted me to let everybody know and give everybody a heads up. We've been noticing quite a few RVs and travel trailers that where people are living, and we know they're living there by the extension cord that runs from the house out to the trailer, and that's, you know, that's a code violation. And so we're going to be contacting those that appear to be occupied, and hopefully they'll comply by, you know, vacating and not living in the travel trailers. And it is a ticketable offense, but we prefer voluntary compliance rather than issuing tickets, but you know, just wanting to give everybody a heads up. It's probably, you know, we're aware of, you know, maybe 6 to 8 locations where this is a problem, but once we start contacting people, they may rat out their friends that are, well, they're doing it too, why can't we? So we may be hearing of other locations. So that's one of the things that they're going to be working on. The other thing
So let me ask you something. So if I had a travel trailer, which I do not, and I had it parked in an appropriate spot at my premises, and I have a cord run out there to it so I can have lights in it and stuff, and I don't live there, is that a code violation?
I believe it is.
So the code violation is the hookup of the electricity, or is it the parking of the vehicle?
I mean, you can have it parked on your own property.
Sure.
But you're saying I can't run an extension cord out there to plug it in?
Isn't there a time limit on that?
I think you're
right. If I remember right, there's a time limit on how long you can't just leave it plugged in for months. But I can't remember the...
We did have an instance recently where someone tried to bury the extension cord.
If I'm buying electricity, it doesn't seem like to me that it's a problem. That's a strange situation.
Because a lot of times people want to keep their refrigerator running if they keep food in there and go every weekend off in it somewhere.
I think the issue has to do with
living. You know, if they're living in it.
Living there. Yeah. I mean, it's the sewer issue. It's the, you know, it's
well, I agree. I just thought it was interesting when she said the extension cord running up to the trailer.
Yeah, well, in each case, folks were living there. I mean, people need to keep up whatever they have. And as long as the plug-in is authorized and, you know, is the right size and into the right socket, it's not a cause of fire, I can't imagine that would be much of an issue.
The people that we bought our home from, they had a travel trailer, and so behind my shop there's a certain size plug-in for RVs, I guess. It's been there since I owned the place.
Well, that's good.
So yeah, that would be legal.
Yeah. And that's what I've got.
It's still an extension cord, though.
But it's properly sized.
It should be a bigger. It should be a bigger one. Mm-hmm. I mean,
I've got one. I'll say
I've got one too.
I don't have an RV ordinance. Got to get in the cart before the horse. Okay.
First thing is the cord.
RV yeah. Yeah. You get the cord, then you
buy the RV.
On your way.
A little piece of time.
Right. Thank you, Mary. Go ahead.
The other thing that they're going to be working on is. And it's kind of irritating to me too, to drive around. People mow their yard except for the strip that's out by the curb, and they let it grow up to, you know, this high. So they're going to be focusing on those locations too. If somebody, you know, doesn't mow out by the curb and it's over the 12-inch limit, they'll be contacting those folks. And it's another good time to remind people that if you mow and you're mower shoots it out into the street, that you should blow it back onto your yard, because you're not supposed to have yard lawn clippings out in the street to be washed away into the sewer and storm sewer. So that's, you know, another thing that they're going to be focusing on.
15th Street would be a great start.
Mm-hmm. There you go. The other thing Oh, yeah. I thought you'd find it interesting. This is what Sharon refers to those as. She says they're, she calls them hairy curbs. That's what she calls them, hairy curbs.
So it's because they don't weed eat the curb?
No, they just don't mow it. They don't
Why don't
mow
you mow the whole yard street? And not mow next to the curb?
Yeah.
I don't know, but
basically
this last go around, someone mowed that strip and left the rest.
I guess it's an every other time thing.
I don't know.
I think it's a rebellion.
I think it is.
Don't you think?
Yeah.
I shouldn't have to do this. So they're not. That's what they do.
And speaking of 15th, like you say, that new sidewalk, it's amazing how many
it looks terrible.
The weeds and that are growing up through the cracks and stuff is just incredible. Yeah,
some people do a great job of keeping those sidewalks nice and clean and without weeds.
Some people
and,
do, but
and others don't.
Harry can't have nice things.
Yeah.
Sure. That's why you have
to
mow a sidewalk.
So I guess we got hairy sidewalks too.
You have hairy sidewalks. They're sprouting hair. Jennifer, she touched on items, the Public Power Week item, and on the and we talked about the crew out at the substation working on the new switcher. So I won't go and talk about that. Dixie Johnson represented us, the City of Perry, last week at the Municipal League Annual Conference in Oklahoma City, and she came back with some good ideas. So. We'll figure out what we can and can't do.
She's dangerous now.
She is now dangerous, yes. And if you're wondering why we have all those items declared surplus on the consent docket, there is a consignment auction that Pickens Auction is having October 1st, and we can piggyback onto that and consign some items to the consignment auction, and so it was just a good opportunity to get rid of some things. We had our own auction, I don't know, a couple, 3 years ago, I can't remember when that was, and got rid of a lot of stuff. So this is a good time. It doesn't require much staff, city staff time to do it, and they'll handle it and take care of it, and then give us our check. That's all I have on my report. Manager report. So unless there's questions, I'm going to move on to the project update.
Let's go update.
Okay. Let's see. Street improvement program. They had the pre-bid last week, and the bid opening will be September 25th, which is next Tuesday, I believe. No, that's not right. It's September 25th. Well, it's that week, and the bid opening, the bid award recommendation should be on the October 3rd council agenda, so I know that's not right because that's a Sunday, so maybe 27th.
Yeah, that'd be a third.
Or Tuesday. 27th is a Tuesday. On sewer master plan projects, the bid recommendation is on tonight's agenda for phase one. We're continuing to do bidding documents for the wastewater treatment plant sludge thickener. That's the one where they went to Weatherford to look at the sludge box, looking at some different way of treating the sludge. And so we're going to try to be more efficient and hopefully less costly when we finish that up. On BMAC, on the irrigation system, Bryce and I and Dixie went out and looked at the irrigation repair work that's underway. They are making progress. I think we're going to give them another couple of weeks and probably see where they, how they come along, and then you know, probably need to put them on notice regardless of whether we think that they're, you know, that it's acceptable or not, just so that we have them on notice that they do have a couple of people from Stillwater working on it. It did require more work in the pump, on the pump area, excavating and pulling that pump out, so, we're hopeful.
Do we have some more tournaments, like, it looks like we have a couple more tournaments?
We've got a couple of more. We've got one coming up this weekend, the 24th and the 25th, and another one on October 15th and 16th. So we've had a couple of, a couple of good tournaments. I do have to brag a little bit. I was, watching my grandson play on a team that I think is, he's pretty young and he's playing with a group of 14-year-olds. I thought he did pretty well. Well, one of the dads that was there, he said, well, I think we played in a tournament in a new park, and I think it was north of the Stillwater exit somewhere. And I said, was it Perry? He said, yeah, I think it was Perry. And they had it, he was with the team, and he said that the facility was fabulous, that whenever they first were told they were coming to Perry, they're all going, kind of rolling their eyes, oh God, what are they getting us into this weekend? And when they got to the park and they saw it, his wife immediately went to the Comfort Inn and got a hotel room and said, we're staying the night. And
then you told him you were the city manager, right?
My husband told him. He pointed to me. I didn't tell him ahead of time. So. But he was extremely complimentary of the facility and the people, the friendliness, just the way the tournament's run. And that really goes a long way, for people that do travel a lot with their kids. That tells you a lot.
We ran into a lot of them this year since we were involved as well. And if you go to Brahms or Le Macarena or even McDonald's and talk to these people, and they were from Wichita, the group that we visited with, and they just absolutely loved it. And I know they came to two, maybe three tournaments and said, they'd be back next year. And they, it makes you feel good.
Yeah. I mean,
because they've got all of the places they can play up there, and
lots.
Indian Springs at over east at Tulsa, and we got people coming here. So,
just for the record, the irrigation that's on the contractor, right?
Yes,
the
it cost is. Of it. Yes, it is. And Bryce, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but we would likely ask for an additional, like, 1 year on the maintenance agreement on that, once it's fixed to our satisfaction, or how
would we
do that?
Well, you can ask. You can ask, but it's part of the it's part of trying to work it out.
Right.
There are issues there, and we do need. I still haven't notified the bondholders
because
we still have time, but it's probably time.
I think the bondholder. I think the bondholder has been notified by the attorney. No, that's a different project.
Yeah, that's a different one. I probably need to put them on notice. But, if we really have a collection of all of the, what all the issues are, and then just list them, because I think it's beyond just, we're past the punch list stage, because we've accepted, and there's still some issues.
You would think, and Mary brings up a good point, once they get all this fixed and you go a couple months without having a problem, then you'd kind of like to see a fresh date of another 1 year warranty to kind of get you through it before this stuff all starts popping up again, and then it's on you.
That can be worked out in the negotiation.
Okay.
It's not an obligation. It's something, because our obligation is the 1 year maintenance bond. And that's running. So, it needs to get fixed. And if the fix is to tear it all up and to make sure it's right and to put down new sod,
Who do we have that inspects it that says it's right?
That's wrong.
Casey?
No, we would have
our building official.
We have a building official, and we also have our architect come over. And the person that they hired, that they have a contract, who's out of Stillwater, can't think of his last name right now. But that was the person who came over and inspected on behalf of the architect. that did the...
Originally?
No, that did the design of the irrigation system.
And how'd that work out?
The design's fine. It was the, installation.
So he did inspect the installation?
He did, and tried to get them to fix it. You know, he told them the things that they needed to do.
And they didn't?
And it was sort of okay, you know, but not like it should be. And as time went on, more and more problems were identified.
So it's not a material problem, it's a...
Well, in some cases, it may be a material problem.
So they used subgrade materials?
Possibly.
Contractors will be contractors.
Could be a mess.
It seems like to me, though, in the last few years, we have inspection problems.
I would think if the inspector noticed there was a problem out there, he'd have thrown a flag and notified somebody and not just stood there and let them go ahead and do it, not change things to what, like he told them he wanted to change.
All right.
Obviously, the Bermuda grass is, you know, going to be going dormant. I mean, doesn't grow much this time of year, so it's going to be going dormant. I don't expect it to die out, you know, just because we don't have the irrigation system, because it's just it's part of the normal seasonal cycle. Moving on, railroad corridor project is progressing. The Corporation Commission approved the project, and BNSF will begin ordering the materials and scheduling the work. The most recent, we've received a notification from BNSF about closing the crossing that we said we'd be willing to close, which is Elm Street. And so that will be occurring. I don't have a date on that. They're supposed to keep us informed, and we agreed that we would place the barricades for the closing so that they can go in there and do the work. And when it all happens, we'll be notifying emergency services. Not too many people, it won't affect too many people directly. Indirectly, it will affect people that use that as a kind of a bypass.
I would think that they'd want to leave that open until they got their project done, especially on Cedar Street. But it seems like to me they get theirs first.
Well,
I just think it's weird how they're going to close their crossing and then turn the tap anywhere else.
The railroad. That's the agreement made. Close one to get three repaired.
You have nothing. We have no...
I can always ask.
We have a dog in the fight.
I can always ask.
We have no control.
Let's hold on.
No, I know that. I just think it's funny how the railroad gets theirs first.
Yeah. Well, they haven't got it yet.
Yeah.
Your crossing hadn't been fixed, has it, Mr. Franklin?
It would be really nice if that could happen for those of us who live on the other side of the tracks.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it'd be nice if they left that open until you get the Cedar Street project done.
Do we know the sequence of construction yet?
I don't.
So we don't even know the sequence.
I don't know the sequence, and so...
we just know that will be closed. It may be closed after they're done, maybe closed. We don't
and
know.
It could be they do the cedar work when the bridge is closed.
There's not a chance of that in the world.
What are the odds of that?
That would be timing. That would be planned. There's no way.
But we have asked if that be coordinated.
Yes, yeah. We did. Well, we did ask that it not be, that they not do any, start any work until after the 16th Cherokee Strip celebration, which they gladly obliged.
They probably said, oh, well, you missed that date. We'll be in the next cycle.
Yeah, you're on the next queue.
On the dam rehabilitation project out at Perry Lake, this project is moving ahead pretty quickly.
Wow.
We commented on the 60% design plans, and we'll probably get the 90% design plans coming in October, I believe it is. So that's when Bryce gets to go to work and work on acquiring easements and other agreements from area property owners.
Not earning money on that one, but
yeah. And then I did meet, I met with the, at the Oklahoma Conservation Commission to discuss funding, state funding for our local share. I didn't finish that up, did I? We are planning. We are planning to have a kind of community informational session where the Conservation Commission would come and talk about the project, NRCS would be there. Incorporate, include our elected officials, all of you, stakeholders. I mean, it, you know, it's pretty much open, you know, could be an open. And it's really basically to kind of talk about the project and what to expect as we get a little bit closer. And it's really just to kind of continue on, because we met individually with all the property owners in that area when we first started, and we'll have another round of those meetings again too. And you know, and Bryce will be meeting individually with ones who need, who we, you know, need to work out any sort of agreements with. So I was very encouraged when I met with the Conservation Commission person in regards to funding for our share. This is a model project, and they want it to go well. And this was where the announcement was made of the federal funding. It's where Congressman Lucas came, and they, you know, the federal folks all came and made the announcement here. Chose Perry and chose the Perry Lake as the location for the announcement. That the money was in the federal farm bill. So everybody has a stake in seeing this succeed, and we're hopeful that everybody will be on board. So we just have to work those relationships and those contacts, continue to work those.
Are there any plans available to look at it all, or are they completed that?
Yeah, but they're 60%. I mean, they've been subject to change, and they've had some changes, but we do have plans to look at it.
Okay. Are they down to stay home? Okay.
We have to, yeah. We do have some information that we need to provide, because we're going to redo our some of our infrastructure out there. We've been in contact with utilities that are going to need to be relocated as a result of that project. So we have some responsibilities on that side of it too, as far as the construction project, construction part of the project. Moving on, the airport, we approved the, accepted the grant offer last meeting, and so that's moving forward. We meet Friday with ODOT to discuss the grant for the sidewalk transportation alternative program, TAP.
TAP.
Yeah, we meet with ODOT on Friday to go through the grant, what the procedures are, what requirements we have to follow, and all of that. So we'll get our marching orders from ODOT on Friday. I think that's all I have.
I have a question back towards the railroad in a minute. A whole different subject. I spent a lot of time in Ponca City, and I noticed that there's areas of Ponca City that they don't blow their train whistles. It's called, I don't know what they call it.
At intersections, you mean?
Yeah.
They're called quiet zones.
Quiet zones. They come in from the north end of Ponca City, and they don't blow their whistle until they hit Grand. And there's signs saying that there's, I don't know what the sign says, but it says something about we don't blow our train horns. I was wondering if anyone knew anything about that. I mean,
there's applications you can file with the railroad to become a zone like that. A lot of military bases do it anymore. It has to do mainly with residents. I don't know. Enid was talking about getting one for Vance Air Force Base, because the general out there, the new commander, didn't like training. I don't know if they got there or not, but I was sitting in a meeting where that was being discussed. And I know it's possible, but I know there's also some stringent criteria on how you do it. And Bryce may have more information on that.
And all of the crossings have to be, yes, you know, have to be right, but I think that's completely worth a, you know, an inquiry about, because...
As many trains as we got coming through.
As many, and, I mean, that really is quite...
especially in the early morning.
Sure.
Well, anymore, I do.
Noise pollution, you know, I mean, really, really, really.
I'm used to it now, I guess.
I can remember, we used to live down in that little trailer park.
I think that's...
By where you guys live.
Worthy.
And I remember the first week, that's when I said, what did we do?
Yeah, I think that's worthy.
What were we thinking?
We've been in that house now for 12 years.
Good question, Billy.
I seem to remember that something, that they had to have different crossing arm barrier types to prevent people from going around the end of the barricade if you don't have any. So there's an investment by the railroad that would involve two arms coming down on both sides. Is that?
I don't remember. I have to pay better attention to that.
But since we have some getting improved, maybe that's
maybe we ought to step them up.
I agree.
I have another question. This is probably silly from years ago. Why do we have on Burr one set of crossing arms and two railroad tracks? Why are there not crossing arms for the other one as well?
I think they've been knocked off from accidents, I believe. I mean, I've seen them.
Well, I saw somebody get trapped in there the other day, and I'm going to tell you right now, the pucker factor would be pretty high on that situation right there.
Well, the west one doesn't even have any. They've never had arms.
No, I didn't think they had either. And that just doesn't make sense to me. And I have not the east one has the arms.
Myself.
Whoops. Yeah.
Well, that's a crossing that's 100% off the railroad to do. You know, and that project is in the works for Fir Avenue. I don't know the timing of it, but I know they've been working on it for a long time.
On crossing arms?
Both crossings on Fir.
Okay.
There's been two accidents with 18-wheelers in the last 3 years.
Yes.
So, and because it's a state highway, the city doesn't have to participate financially.
And one more question. I've missed a meeting or two. I call it the Crystal Project. Have we gotten anything hammered out yet out there in front of the Macarena on getting that median moved?
It's in the books.
And I'm not trying to, I'm sorry. I didn't
We awarded a contract on that at the last meeting, I believe.
Okay.
To J&D in the amount of about $25,000.
Okay. Thank you very much.
We've given them the notice to proceed, I think we've gotten all their insurance that they're required. It's less than the $50,000, so they don't have as many requirements to meet on. You know, like it would be if it's a public construction contract.
Okay. I apologize for the redundancy. I didn't look back.
We missed you.
Yeah, a little bit.
A lot.
All right. Are we through with our city manager?
Sorry, Chris.
Any further questions, comments, concerns? All right, item 7, our chief financial officer.
Poor Meredith.
Meredith.
Oh, dude. That was not cool.
You're out of time.
Wow. Yeah.
Never mind then. Just read your report. I'm done.
You've read it already. Any questions?
Yes, you've read it already. Yeah. Quickly, I will give you the overview. August 31st numbers, total cash, a little over $13 million. We're up about 1.5% from where we were last month, basically just timing of receipts and payments. I do want to point out specifically under that total column, moving down halfway down the page, the sewer project, the 2015 bonds, you all have this on your agenda to approve in just a little bit. We've got a little over $3 million just in that project, those bonds that we have not spent. I know we've got on the agenda to approve of it. So it would come out of that $3 million if you so choose. No questions on cash because I couldn't answer them anyway since I'm not Russ. All right. Flipping to the general fund, where 17% of the year is of August. So things look pretty good. Even though when you look at that bottom line, we're losing a little over $300,000, it looks rough. but we know that we've had some capital improvements. We know that we've had some debt payments that have come out, most specifically and the Vance building that we ended up paying in July. And a little over $200,000 is significantly impacting that bottom line number. Sales tax itself, right on budget at 17%. When I compare year over year, actually specifically month over month, we had a really good month this time last year, like $172,000 worth of sales tax. We're down to $143,000 this month. So I didn't take the time to go back and look specifically what it hit a year ago, but our sales tax has been consistent since we started this fiscal year, around that $143,000 since the beginning of the fiscal year. So you all started out with a good budget. I think the projection was good. I think we're gonna be able to hit it. As it shows right now, we are. Other than that, kudos to the fire department. They did get a portion of their forestry grant. We expected that to come in. That's the reason there's 48% of their budget. And to the ballpark, we budgeted $4,000 for their revenues, and they're already twice that. So those fall tournaments have been helpful as far as concessions and gate receipts. So strong there.
Good.
Questions on general fund? Okay. Oh,
no.
No,
you're good.
Okay. Municipal authority.
Hotel tax receipts
were good. I'm sorry?
Hotel tax receipts were good.
Yes, hotel is strong. Over $20,000 on hotel tax receipts. So, yes, strong as well. You know that we ramped that down just a little bit because we expected there to be a little crunch as far as visitors, but I think the ballpark has helped stay consistent there. Okay, Perry Municipal Authority, our moneymaker, clearing $884,000 for our first 2 months. Gives us a profit margin of about 35%. That's what we need right now. People are using their air conditioner and they're watering their lawns. Although we have not had a super hot summer, they are actually using electricity, which is great, and they're using water. Our budget, we only budget about a 23% profit margin. So the fact that we're at that 35% margin, a little over $880,000, this is what we need. This is the seasonality. We won't continue to see this. People will shut down their air conditioners, but it's something positive for right now. Energy office revenue, it's at 0%. That's our cups. That's what Jennifer talked about. So we'll get that in. Taking down to net income, a little over $330,000 of net income. Compare that profit with over on our general fund side, the loss, we're at about a break even, despite the fact that we've had our debt payments and some capital improvements. So pretty good position 2 months of the year. Questions? Or you can ask them to rest when he shows up.
Questions, comments, concerns? Thank you, Meredith.
I think you did a great job, man.
Item 8, consider approval ordinance 2016-13, amending Chapter 11 of the Perry Municipal Code of 2013, as supplemented by the amendment of Article 2, entitled Cemetery, by the addition of Section 11216, entitled Purchase of Lots from Owner, providing for the Peeler, Savings Clause, Codification, Severability Penalty, and declaring an emergency. We have put in here some adjustments in the cost for purchasing lots and the cost for services. They were outlined in Section 8. Any comments or questions or discussion?
We found that there was a resolution passed back in, I can't remember how long ago it was.
25 years ago.
Yeah, when Mayor MD was, I think it was Mayor MD.
Hollingsworth.
Hollingsworth, oh, well, that was a long time ago.
So, 92.
Anyway, that established the, if someone wants to sell their lots back to the cemetery, there was a process for that and how much, the city would pay. And as a result of the changes that the council approved last week, we had a situation where people were making money by selling their lots back to us. And so what we, and since it was only a resolution that provided provided for that process felt like it was important to actually put it into ordinance form and put it in the city code so that we don't have to rely on someone's memory that there was a resolution passed, because resolution really, it has intent of the council at the time it was passed, and we continue to follow it until it's changed, but it doesn't have the force of law that an ordinance would have. And it just makes sense to have it all in the ordinance, have it all in the city code, so that there isn't any room for misunderstandings or anything like that. So anyway, this is provides for a process for repurchasing of lots from owners, and it puts it into the city code.
Move to approve.
Second.
Motion second to approve. Roll call, please.
Strong.
Yes.
Moore.
Yes.
Ebersol.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Coler.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes.
Motion on emergency.
Second.
Yes.
Morrill.
Yes.
Ebersol.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Coler.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes.
Thank you. Item 9, consider awarding fuel bids. The city bid is fuel out to two and received two bids. Kenman's Oil was the successful and only bidder on off-road red diesel at a maximum discount of 10 cents per gallon over cost. OnQ Express was a successful bidder on unleaded gasoline, premium unleaded gasoline, and premium number two diesel at a maximum discount of 15 cents per gallon. Your recommendations?
Motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion second. The award of the bid. Roll call, please.
Strong.
Yes.
Moore.
Yes.
Ebersol.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Coler.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes. Thank you, Council. Item 10, consider canvas of bids on the citywide sewer, sanitary sewer phase one capital improvements. Award the bid to lowest responsible bidder. Authorize mayor to execute public construction contract to lowest responsible bidder, subject to approval of bonds and insurance by the city attorney. We did receive bids on September 13th, and this is the phase one of our $3 million projects. This is the lowest bidders you see there with Urban Contractors at $667,588. What is your recommendation?
That's amazing that they can bid less than half of what the high bidder was. Just amazing.
The two high bidders, TriStar and Nowak, are both out of Kansas, so they have a little more mobilization costs, possibly
employee expenses.
Urban and Kraft Reynolds are both they do a lot of the pipe bursting, which is the procedure that we're going to use rather than do the open trenching. And so we hadn't really heard of Urban Contractors, but we did checks on them, and everything turned out, you know, we're hearing really good things about them. So they're one of the top ones in the state that utilizes the pipe bursting method. So the amount in the agenda was $667,588, and there were a couple of additional items. One was aggregate for the alleys, which they bid $40,800. And then also additional sewer pipe cleaning and TV inspection for $27,200. I don't have, you know, I was needing to get the engineer's direction on that or their recommendation, and whether to include that in our award. So we may just go ahead and stick with the $667,000, and then if we need to do a change order, we can do a change order.
I think it's good.
Make a motion we award the bid to Urban Contractors in the amount of $667,588.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Strong.
Yes.
Morrill.
Yes.
Ebersol.
Yes.
Marshall.
Yes.
Franklin.
Yes.
Gilbert.
Yes.
Coler.
Yes.
Johnson.
Yes.
Item 11, appointment to the Board of Adjustment. The terms of Jenny Wade, Brian Wheatley, and Sherry Scott on the Board of Adjustment are expiring this month. All three of these people have shown their interest to continue in that position if we wish them to. So we can either confirm the appointments with these three people, or if you got somebody else, you need to let us know.
Motion to confirm the appointments.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Strobel?
Yes.
Morrow?
Yes.
Eversole?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Franklin?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Coburn?
Yes.
Johnson?
Yes. Item 12, new business. Any new business need to come before the council this evening? New business. Seeing none. Item 13, consider convening into executive session for the purpose of conferring on a matter pertaining to the economic development of the city of Perry to discuss the proposals South Commercial Park to create, retain jobs, payroll, and increase or continue tax collection as public disclosure would interfere with the development and implementation of the proposal pursuant to 25 OS 307C10. Conferring on a matter pertaining to economic development, City of Perry to discuss business proposals, create jobs, and payroll related to medical fields as disclosure would interfere with development implementation of the proposal pursuant to 25 OS 307C10. The other item on there will be no action tonight, so it won't be discussed in executive session. So just two items.
Make a motion, we convene an executive session.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Strobel?
Yes.
Morrow?
Yes.
Eversole?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yes.
Franklin?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Coburn?
Yes.
Johnson?
Yes.
I can't tell you about it.
Please, no. See the red already? It's just that quick.
Seriously though, you won't ride a motorcycle, William? Or you just
make like a motion, we
reconvene.
Second.
Roll call, please.
Strobel?
Yes.
Morrow?
Yes.
Eversole?
Yes.
Marshall?
Yep.
Franklin?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Coburn?
Yes.
Johnson?
Yes. Thank you. Do we need to take any action necessary pursuant to executive session?
Make a motion, we adjourn.
Motion to adjourn and second. Roll call.
Strobel?
Yes.
Morrow?
Yes.
Eversole?
Yes.
Marshall?
Aye.
Franklin?
Yes.
Gilbert?
Yes.
Coburn?
Yes.
Johnson?
Aye. Thank you, council. Good meeting.